first of all, I feel like the goal process as a filmmaker for me is to have an idea and then spend 2 years executing that idea. And so as I'm in post-production on one movie, I start thinking ideas start coming for the next movie. And they've now become a very complicated process. Before it used to be, oh, I got a good idea, I'm just gonna write that. Then it became, well, I have a couple good ideas, which one can I inject meaning into? So then that was a different level. And now there's like 8 levels to my decision making. So an idea has to have all these characteristics, that it can have meaning, that it can have suspense, that it can have emotion, the humanity, and that it has a global significance and that it has a universal message that people in India and Japan and Philadelphia, that everybody can relate to it, that I'm touching on some connection between people, and that it feel like a great roller coaster ride all the same. An idea that can hold all that without bending it too far takes a while to come up with. And so finally this idea came and it bent to all those things so easily. And also I'm really looking for clean stories, not something too complicated. It needs to feel like one movie to me. So like this movie is all on a farm, all one family in one place. And so when you leave it, you'll know what it felt like to be on this farm and be with this family during this very kind of horrific time.
One of the things that's really interesting about the way Knight writes is that he covers a lot of different elements, and there are a lot of different layers to his stories and to his scripts. And what I really enjoyed about reading Signs when I first read it was that he was tackling another genre. I think he's sort of approached genres that we've seen before in movies in his own unique way, and he did that with The Sixth Sense and with Unbreakable, and I think he's doing it again with Signs. Another layer that Knight likes to incorporate into his stories are real-life occurrences. He bases a lot of his background and character information on things that have happened in real life.
Knight's original big concept and where the title Signs came from is the whole notion of the crop circles. Now, there are a number of people who remember this from the early 80s, where there were a lot of these signs showing up in various parts of the world, mostly in fields of wheat. And there was a lot of speculation as to whether or not it was actually something that was being done by pranksters and wasn't real, or in fact it was a sign from outer space. And Knight chose to do these signs in cornfields because for anyone who's ever grabbed a stalk of corn, you realize it's extremely difficult to bend, let alone flatten 300-400 yards of cornfields. So the fact that these signs appear in cornfields definitely means that they are most likely not man-made.
Crop circles are something that's always been of interest to me. The beauty and the grandeur of them, just the mystique that no one's taking credit for them. They've happened all around the world. A lot of publicized ones in England, plenty of them in the United States. I think there's 600 in India, so it's a kind of a phenomenon that people have caught on to, and it's always been something that's intrigued me as a subject. And that's the kind of the platform for the movie that it springs from, the crop circles. But it started there with that fascination about that supernatural event. That was the subject matter, but the style of the movie and the things that really affected me came from basically 3 movies, and those 3 movies were The Birds as the main influence of a kind of this supernatural event that was happening that has no explanation. And then subsequently, the aspect of that movie where it all ends up in a house. And then there's another movie, which is Night of the Living Dead, which all ends up in a house as well, to this phenomenon again that's happening. And then, of course, the kind of subtle but powerful suspense that came from the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers. I definitely feel akin to older filmmaking than today's filmmaking, where rather than showing the killer coming with the bloody knife, I would hear a noise and the lights would be on the room, or it would be something in the room that's still moving and you show that and then the victim realizes there's someone in the room. All that's scarier, the realization in the mind of what's coming, rather than cutting to the guy with the bloody knife, which means don't worry about what scares you, this is what we think scares you. And that's usually 99% of the time very limiting. So if you can give the audience a way to relate, then they'll feel so much more because they'll be imagining what it felt like to go through this supernatural journey. This movie needed to have a journey other than the physical one that's happening. And Tak Fujimoto and I, we talk about the movie as a metaphor, as a conversation between God and this one man. So with regard to the title, Signs, it definitely has two meanings. One is the crop signs that they find in their yard, but it's also talking about the faith and the existence of signs from above in a kind of a heavenly manner. And the main character played by Mel Gibson is a man who's lost faith, who's actually in search of signs that there's somebody out there watching over them.
What Knight so successfully does is he always has a subtext to his stories. And this is about a man regaining his faith. And so there's a strong, strong emotional sensibility to the entire story that runs throughout Mel Gibson's character.
Supernatural movies kind of have a disclaimer in the beginning, say none of this is real, wink, wink, so let's just have some fun with it. But what if this really happened? This is what you would feel, this is what you would say, and then you come out of it that way with some journey that the characters went through and take something away then. So it's as powerful as a dramatic movie. So, we have some new members to the team and some returning members. Generally, the philosophy on the last three movies, this one being third, has been to basically write a visual script. After I've written a script, to write a visual script, every frame of the movie, walk through it in my head. I feel much more comfortable as a filmmaker for me, making decisions in a pressureless room situation where I go, well, what if we went for this through the window and we did this, and then Rick and I will sit talk and say, wow, that'll cause a problem because of this, or I won't be able to light because of this. We'll do as much thinking as we can in advance, and this book represents what, how about three months of intense, painful work of us together in a room, and she'd represent the worst that this movie can be. So it can only get better from this point on. I make the movie visually way before we make the movie. It's really an important thing for me, you know, maybe because I'm a control freak, I don't know, but it's a feeling of, I know I got the movie. I understand its nature, I understand where to go, and so when we get on the set, I know where I'm gonna use it, and so we don't have to do any extra stuff.
We open the movie on this is basically our icon shot of the movie. A shot, you know, looking down in the backyard, ideally you see, you know, a taste of the crops at the top of the frame, and you get a real sense that you like this family from what you see.
His scripts are very visual, they read very visually, which is not always the case. Some scripts, I think, and some directors are more verbal, but Knight's very visual. Well, he's actually both, you know, being the writer and the, you know, and director. We'll start on page one, scene one, and usually he has some ideas that he's already thought about. So we discuss the scene a lot, exactly what kind of feelings he wants to evoke and the emotions of the characters and what the scene is about. And then often I'll do a lot of kind of real quick thumbnail sketches right on the spot. And we actually do three passes, really. And we'll do an initial, totally conceptual pass, often before the designer's even been brought in. So then once the sets are built and we have locations, we'll do another pass, usually, and kind of adjust the sketches for this new information. And then we usually take a third pass, sometimes after he's already done some rehearsing with actors, and he really uses the process well. So it's the first chance to turn the, you know, the script into pictures.
As a producer, selfishly, you got this blueprint. You have a script, and you have visual pictures that represent the script. So it means that you can precisely plan what you need for the movie in terms of sets and locations and props and wardrobe. So there's little room for kind of error, and there's little room for waste. So it's a wonderful process.
We're in Bucks County, Pennsylvania, looking at the set, which is owned by an agricultural college. And they've let us use all their property here. Grow corn, as you can see over here, and build our house.
One of the most important things for this movie, and I think for all of Knight's movies, is the look of the movie. It's very controlled for reasons that contribute to the storytelling of the movie. And Larry Fulton was challenged with the task of finding a place where all of the things that Knight had written in the script could be realized on a location, on a real location, because Knight wanted to do this on a real location. And obviously with all of this corn and everything here, we had to do it in a real place. So we sent the location scouts out to look for 40 or 50 acres of land where we could grow corn at a certain time, and it could be ready at a certain time, and we could make corn circles, and we could also have a wonderful landscape and sort of horizon line. There are a lot of elements that had to figure into this. The other thing that was fabulous about this location is we're on Delaware Valley College, which is an agricultural college, so they knew how to grow corn.
So they're just going to plant corn from here all the way to the tree?
Right now that is corn down there.
Where that big circular field.
Right, that's all in corn.
Okay.
It's a little bit behind that corn.
Okay.
So we'll have kind of that height of corn, then we'll have this kind of corn.
Right.
We did grow this corn out here on purpose at a certain time, and we had to start shooting at a certain time. It's also kind of interesting that we tried a new watering technique. I think we used reclaimed water, and the corn grew so well that the college wants to now examine and see what we did so that they can make it part of their agricultural program.
That's fantastic.
I like it because it'll lay in the crevices real nice and it'll sort of creep out.
I wanted to shoot this on location on a farm. So we've made the house and the barn and the backyard, and here we are, and it's just a fantastic thing. You know, we've been shooting nights here, and when you're here at nighttime, it's kind of a magical place.
Now that's iconic.
Yeah, I mean, even, you know, like the chase around the house,
right.
being low and
yeah,
getting the shadows on the walls and stuff.
It's such a shame.
I showed him pictures of Bucks County places, and we came up with the idea that it shouldn't be so much about a Bucks County kind of stone farmhouse, but that it would be more about an American farmhouse. So our farmhouse is a Victorian one that would be as comfortable here as it would be in the Midwest. It's sort of an iconic American farmhouse. And then we started playing with the idea that the house, when you look at it very long, you see that it's shades of red, white, and blue. And the metaphor there is that this house standing here is America, and it's standing alone in the middle of this field, and its strongest protection is what that family shares with each other. So there's lots of research on crop circles, and I used a lot of books, researched a lot, and first suggested that we create a pie shape and then CGI the rest of the circle. Knight doesn't like CGI work, so he wants everything practical. Because in this movie, we have our star crop circle that we see on the farm, but we also have crop circles that are shown in different parts of the world. So in pre-production, we went to Rochester, New York, and created an English crop circle and an Indian crop circle. The most difficult thing is the fact that it takes place almost single-handedly, completely inside and outside the farmhouse. So the idea that this house had to be a very big part of this movie.
The farm is the backbone in terms of the set structure of the movie. So we built our farm exteriors right in the middle of this cornfield. We did a few interior scenes on location that show that you are really at the farm, and then we built some wonderful stage sets. And then the sets transcended that whole look and design in terms of color and use of backings, and obviously Tak Fujimoto's, you know, lighting design and cinematography.
There's a lot of religious iconography in the film. Graham's character has lost his faith, and one of the opening shots of the movie has just the shadow of a cross on a bedroom wall. The metaphor for me was to say that a man may decide that he's lost his faith, but his faith is always going to be around him. There's like all kinds of icons of faith and belief and religion tucked away in the house for people to find. There's lots of signs around.
Looks a little like our house, doesn't it? Is it possible that there are no coincidences?
Race truck swerved off the road and hit a Colleen and then a tree, and she was pinned between the two.
What does that mean, pinned?
The day before we started filming was the day after September 11th, and so we in the world were all dealing with the repercussions of that event, and also that we were starting with something important.
Carolyn, this is the last time I'm going to talk with my wife.
Yes, it is.
I had not worked with Mel Gibson before, and the idea was to kind of break the ice right away and do one of the most important scenes, if not the most important scene, on the first day, and just get it all out, go through that whole process and get to the meat of things.
Does it hurt?
I don't feel much.
Good.
Because it was a night shoot, I had to kind of go to bed really late to kind of get my body used to going into a couple of night shoot nights and not be overwhelmed. So I tried to sleep late, but I couldn't. I was too anxious, and I got up. Just looked at all the notes. We had prepped like crazy for this, and I went to the forest, which is where we shot this, in this beautiful forest. It was really magical. As we began that day, and we did a candlelight vigil before we started shooting, everybody raised the candle, and it was, we were all pretty, you know, crying at that point before we even started rolling, on a scene where we're doing basically a man and woman last conversation to each other before she dies. So it was charged, the air was supercharged. And then Mel Gibson comes to the set and he's in his priest outfit for the first time. And probably when I'm an old man, I'll probably remember that day as a big day. Technically, in chronological order, the first scene that happened in the characters' lives is the first scene that we shot, the mother dying. That happened 6 months ago. But the movie actually starts with Mel waking up and suddenly having this bad feeling about something. And you get introduced one by one to the characters along the way.
Where are they?
And so it was one of those classic James Bond beginnings, an action sequence. Get everybody's blood pumping and then start the movie.
He understands the language of film. And not only that, he really loves what he does, so that he transmits that and he really wants to talk about it. He has a very good understanding of how he wants to see the story and what he wants to extract from it, technically on film and from performance. I mean, those are things you talk about on the spot. He doesn't settle for the usual kind of, oh, that was good enough.
Come on, let's go. What is that? Who is that for? Let's go.
It was for you.
And he'll even say, well, that was good, but like, hey, I want something else. I want something more. I want something. And you sort of like, okay, you shut it down. And he's picked up on a couple of my shortcuts, you know, bad habits, tricks I've learned over the years to get around most people, and they'll sort of eat it up, but he won't buy it. He's very observant. So he pushes you just a little further to extract something more from you, which is nice. And I know some people will get their noses out of joint by something like that, saying, what, you don't like what I'm offering you? What'd you hire me for? But for me, it's just a great learning experience.
On the count of three. One, two, three.
The thing I wanted to bring after Unbreakable was the humor. So this movie, I really wanted to enjoy their confusion about what was happening.
Is this ridiculous, or am I the only one?
So it was really fun. And then I forgot about it, and as we cast the movie, you know, cast all these amazing serious actors, then in dailies, when we first watched the first dailies, everybody's laughing in dailies, and I was like, oh yeah, this is kind of funny.
Excluding the possibility that a female Scandinavian Olympian was running around outside our house last night, what else might be a possibility?
So when I saw the kind of the humor rising up and becoming one of the giant elements of the movie, I was really psyched.
And I need to, don't cover yourself up, Rory. You gotta feel the camera. You know how I always tell you about feeling the camera and you keep covering yourself up? Feel that camera, I need to feel your face. Okay?
We actually had a read through, which is a wonderful thing, which you don't always get. And then we do a couple of rehearsals. But he really uses each take in a way as a rehearsal. He gives you so many different notes throughout the different takes that you're allowed to play it many different ways, hopefully always honing in closer to his ideal vision of the scene. But he loves giving the actors all the opportunity in the world to create something that's fresh and original, and it's cool.
There's a great camaraderie on this set for a number of reasons. I think a large portion of the crew have worked on all of Knight's films. And so there's this great sense of community. And Knight just has a wonderful energy about him. He's very soothing, and I think that rubs off on everybody. And Mel is just an inspiration. I theorize that after making 50 trillion movies, an actor would become somewhat callous or dead to the process in a sense. But Mel completely proved that theory wrong.
with Joaquin, he's a terrific young actor. Just doing scenes with him, you get a lot. He feeds you a lot. You can only give it back. He gives a lot, so that's fantastic. So there doesn't seem to be a lot of huge egos at work here.
If I had made this movie 2 years ago, I think I would have done the wrong thing. Because the way it popped into my head was, we'll stay in a house with a family and never leave the house. And it'll be a War of the Worlds happening. And I just said, you know what? That's not the correct way to motivate this movie. That is the feeling that I want to get, is the claustrophobia of the house. But don't be so restrained, because I think that organic ideas won't come that way. How can you maintain that spirit and still keep the movie alive? And so I said, you know what? Let me do this town sequence where they go to town just for in the first act of the movie, they all go to town to try to get their minds off of this weird stuff that's happening. And so it was such a wonderful way to kind of go to town and then have these people separate. And we learn backstory on all of them.
Do you have any books on extraterrestrials?
I am not a reverend anymore.
You've got 2 minor league home run records, don't you?
5.
It's contaminated.
Carl, there's something wrong with our water.
And then they come back together and we're back to the plot of the crop circles and what does it mean.
What if it's catching a signal from them?
There's always one scene that I write in my screenplays that has a lot of parts to it, and it's often cut out of my movies. And from the moment I wrote the baby monitor scene was like, this is the scene that's gonna get cut out of the movie. What can I do to make sure in advance that it doesn't get cut out?
Mel, when he takes the baby monitor, put your hand down, and then say, Morgan, I say, get down.
Okay,
here we go. Ready? Are we rolling?
And of course, when we went to shoot it, we had all kinds of problems. And then you listening to the sound, now you start to slowly look over at your dad's hand who's holding the monitor. I just couldn't get the tone right because it was a very complicated scene. Now go to the up position. Turn. And it really was 3 parts, you know, the interior of the car, the standing outside the car, so we were shooting through the doors, and then on top of the car. It's so fragmented over such a long period of time that you can't tell if it's matching, if the flow is working. And it's a pivotal scene because it basically is the last moment that the family kind of enjoys this phenomenon in a fun way. And it was just a very tricky thing.
There's 2 of them talking.
I'm amazed it's in the movie.
Cut. Okay, cool. Back to one.
Okay, here we go. Very quiet.
People break down into 2 groups.
That was one of those kind of hold your breath scenes because you're writing something that you can't do these days, 6-7 page scene of dialogue where nothing happens, where they just sit there and talk. So the action and the special effects are all the dialogue and all the performance. And Joaquin doesn't really like to rehearse, so we would just talk about the spirit of it.
Some people are probably thinking this is the end of the world.
And Mel's big speech is so tricky to say because it's like group A, group B, group number 1, group number 2, and you can get really confused and it's very long, so that wasn't sure it was gonna happen. And then we did Joaquin's side first, and he just rocks it. And then we turned around to shoot Mel's side, and he has to go to the White House. His movie that he was making, We Were Soldiers, he was showing for the White House. And I said, you know what? Let's not do this. We'll come back and do this tomorrow. But he goes, we're gonna do this scene now.
Group number 1 sees it as more than luck, more than coincidence. They see it as a sign.
It was an amazing moment of a great artist inspiring another great artist who then inspired me and everybody just getting inspired, and he got up and, you know, you realize why he's a superstar.
These places marked in crops and such, none of them are really near water. I don't think they like water.
Well, the decision to act in the movie is one of combined terror and desire to try to do more in my movies and be more personal, make the movies more personal, and a desire to express myself in different ways, writing, directing, acting. And I felt like there was this role that I really, really connected to when I wrote it. And so I was terrified to do it. And if I failed this, I would hurt the movie. And the funny thing was, Mel didn't realize I was playing the role. So when we did the scene, he was like, "You're in it." And I'm like, "Yeah, is that okay?"
People who kill reverends' wives aren't exactly ushered to the front of the line in heaven.
On a kind of sad note, the day before my scene in the movie, we shot the movie, my grandfather passed away. And I had a picture of the candle vigil from the first day of the shoot in my pocket and a picture of my grandfather in my pocket. And we did the scene, and it was like the perfect day. It was the perfect day. I am so glad that I did it for myself, you know. And the movie is much more personal to me because of that.
You can keep coming forward, though. It just kind of slows you. That's when you see the shadow. It's moving. Then you say hello.
Hello. Stop.
The pantry sequence was called our swing set because we built that set. And whenever we lost the kids, you know, when I say we lost the kids, it means we only have a certain amount of time to shoot the kids. And if we run out of that time, that's it. By law, that's it. So they go home, and what are we going to do? Well, let's go to the swing set, and we go there and we shoot one shot of the pantry scene. And so we shot that over like 2-3 weeks, one shot at a time. So when you lean in, it's just frustration. You can't see enough. I'm going to do another shot into the door where I see you kind of searching. You can't see anything. Come up, trying to figure this out. How can I get a look at what's in there without getting too close?
The police are here. I'm with them. I am a police officer.
In a comedic way, he's going to go and find out once and for all that this is not a hoax. I had him do this kind of very cheesy TV cop thing. You know, I said, go as cheesy as you can with the cop thing.
Just tell us your name and why you did it, and we'll give you the same deal we gave the others.
And he was just really having fun with that.
You want to see, but you're going to go down. Don't step forward. You're just going to go down right where you are. You're too scared to move forward.
He leans forward, and then he goes, this is ridiculous. I'm not going to put my face right up to the edge of the door. And he gets up and walks away, and there's a great sense of like, all right, now I've played with you, toyed with you on a string this whole time. Now, Mel, I want you to just come back and do everything you just did in 10 times the speed.
What you're about to see may disturb you.
Everybody look out the window until he calls me, ready?
Wake up, wake up!
We had to shoot the Brazilian video, and then we had to shoot Joaquin watching the Brazilian video to make one scene, so there was actually two separate scenes there. And the Brazilian video, I knew I wanted it all one shot, so it would look authentic, no cuts and stuff like that. Handheld, and Joaquin just kind of watching from this closet. And now you see it for the first time, but you don't really see it.
Move, children! Vamanos!
I'm so glad it came out the way I had hoped it would, you know, with the electricity of the kids screaming. And I remember when we did Joaquin's side of it, he was doing these amazing reactions here. And then I said, you know, in the last one, I said, end up in the coats. He's like, what? And I said, I want you to be in the coats at the end. And he backed up into the coats, and then he watched and goes, ah, and, you know, and then grabbed the chair and came forward and all. And I was like, that is definitely in the movie. And when we finished, I was like, check the gate. That's definitely in the movie.
What do you want, Morgan?
Anything? French toast. And mashed potatoes.
Now we're talking.
The Last Supper, we shot so fast because it was just happening for real. And there's the four of them at the table, and we have four shots to do. And I say, all right, let's start with the little girl.
I had to do this huge crying scene because my brother said that you let mom die. So I'm crying so much, and little bits of tears were coming down.
She just did a beautiful take, and I called cut, and everyone was just stunned. So then it was like, who wants to go next? And then, you know, who wants to follow that? Well, Rory Culkin goes in there, and then he just tears it up.
She started crying, and I didn't know she could do that. And right when it said cut, everyone was put their heads down, was so sad. And Knight walked over and said, okay, who wants to follow that up? And we all backed our chairs away. And Joaquin would, but then Knight asked me if I'm emotional from seeing her cry. That means I should go next, so pretty much what happened. I was crying because I saw her crying. It was sad.
And he blew it away. Again, two takes, just blew it away. And I moved to Mel as fast as we could. And Mel has to do this amazing physical performance because he has to be emotional while eating. And if anybody's ever tried to do that, it's impossible. It's two separate things. And it was so powerful. And I was like, whew. The whole thing, which we had scheduled the whole day, took 4 hours. Not even 4 hours, probably like 3 hours. And I knew we had had one of those great moments on film. Door handle? The movie is supposed to evolve into this kind of nightmare situation, and really the basement is kind of like their hell almost. And immediately when we started doing it, I said, you know what, why don't we shoot this all with flashlights?
Got it!
It's very powerful to just see rooms lit by flashlights and then absolute darkness. And when the lights go out in the theater and you just see everybody gasp, it's such a great thing, you know. I'm taking away everything that they can feel safe about. And when we shot the asthma attack, we were getting crushed by our schedule. We were supposed to be in the basement for a full week and we're running out of time. And everybody's getting instructions and it's like totally wartime. And it was one of those moments, and we just sat down in the dark in this basement, and we had a half hour to shoot this whole asthma attack.
Don't be afraid, Morgan. We'll slow this down together.
And Mel just kind of exposed his very dark side when he says, I hate you. It's the first time he actually acknowledges that there's something up there, and the way he acknowledges it is through hate.
I hate you.
The rhythm of the speech was kind of like driving, and then it would... And it would come in bursts, and it was sort of to himself, and it was not repetitive, but using the same words in different ways, meaning different things.
The fear is feeding. Don't be afraid of what's happening. Believe it's going to pass. Believe it. Just wait. Don't be afraid.
That's his first step towards faith, was saying, acknowledging that it's there. You know, I'm pretending you weren't there for the whole movie, you know, but that's a lie. Okay, I'm lying about that, but you're there, but I hate, that's not a lie, I hate you. And he gets through this nightmare with his child, and then he's a different person, you know, at the end of this. I think that he's faced facing his nightmares one at a time.
Okay, that's a visual alien, right?
Right.
It was just whether or not there'd be a reaction in his hands.
Right.
To hitting the alien. And my contention was no. I'd rather see the blur of this shot and then a clean swing as though he came across his chin. You wouldn't see a reaction in his hands. And
it looks. The scene about faith is really about seeing something that's not there because there wasn't anything there for them to see.
Action.
And so that was a real kind of going into a new place with these actors and everything. And this is just a really, really tricky thing to do when nothing's there.
Come across the lens as much as you can.
It's a part of acting. I mean, it's just another element that you must have in your arsenal of tricks as an actor. You know, you need a lot of help with your imagination. Kind of help me out, help me picture this. What is this going to look like, and where is it going to be positioned? So my reaction, you know, does this make sense? This is how I imagined it. And it is difficult, but I have a pretty good sense of ultimately how it will look.
Hey, take one.
I tried to shoot, as much as I can in sequence without getting crazy with the costs, you know. And in this movie, it naturally lent itself to that because it was mostly the outdoor stuff was early. Then we went into the house. So once we were in the house, we just shot in sequence in the house. The only thing that was out of sequence was the end scene outside in the backyard, which we had to shoot maybe at the halfway point of the movie. So that was you know, tough. I wish I didn't have to. But by the time we got to it, if we waited, it would have been winter outside. And so we wanted to do it in a kind of a way that was kinetic and real and not in the movie. I wanted to shake you up. So we left kind of the orchestrated shots and went to a handheld shot outside, which made you feel like, hey, even in the slightest way, is this not gonna work out for us?
Don't touch him, give him a minute.
That moment of what it feels like to feel his epiphany, you know, when you hear the boy say,
Dad?
We pan to Joaquin and the girl, it goes into a tiny bit of slow motion, like they're feeling this rush of a miracle. And it's just those little things, I think, that make you feel, you know, what the characters are feeling.
Did someone save me?
I think someone did.
I saw this kind of Norman Rockwell opening and closing of, you know, the perfect backyard with the swing and the, you know, the crops in the corner and everything's perfect, American ideal. And that at the end of the movie, the American ideal has changed a little because it's shattered glass, but it's still beautiful. As we pan around the room to make it one shot and all of a sudden it's snowing in the other windows and then we go into the bathroom door where we saw him come out in the beginning. And he comes out in his priest outfit, and I don't want him to say anything. I just want him to get dressed and walk out, and that would be the last moment. And it was really powerful. It was the last shot that we did, and it's the last take that we did that's in the movie. And, of course, it's take number 6. That number has particular significance to me.
And Gates good!
Yeah!
This was the rare occasion that the script really held its form as it was written, and you know, the movie will have a pedigree of emotion. It will have been born of the right things, of the right motivations of faith and love and true moments of all of us, that everybody came to the movie and gave a little piece of their lives and their heart. It's a wonderful little EKG of all of our emotions, and I can't wait to see how it all came together and then see the reaction of the audience, you know?
What's the matter?
There's a monster outside my room. Can I have a glass of water?
Ready? Settle there in the background. Action! Go now. This is my first journey with CGI, and it was brutal. It was absolutely brutal because literally you have an entirely new job to do while you're making the movie with CGI, and I didn't realize how much the process needed me to have a vision in advance for that crew. And it was definitely a big learning process because it took twice as long, took twice as many people, took twice as much effort as we had originally planned on. And as hands-on as I am with the music, with the screenplay, obviously, with the actors, I mean, literally, you have to do that and go through that process with this huge crew that's doing the special effects.
So let's start with the creature itself.
Yeah, we got some new stuff.
Whoa. When Knight came up with the idea, the presence, I'll call it, in this movie, we talked a long time, all of us, about just exactly what that would be and what people would see and what the audience would think they would see. Knight does a very interesting thing in the style of the way he shoots movies. By creating a sense of suspense, he sits on long shots with a great deal of confidence and patience, and he wants the audience to begin to sit in their seat and move forward. He wants you to wonder what you're looking at. It should be very subliminal. You should almost turn to the person sitting next to you and say, what was that? The restraint that Knight has in his storytelling and what he chooses to show you is definitely Hitchcockian. The whole idea that the imagination can give you so much more than anything that you necessarily put in front of somebody, and waiting as long as possible to show the audience, creates a much more suspenseful, thrilling kind of scene.
Traditionally, when you're setting out to create a monster for a movie, what you do is you come up with a broad palette of options. And so we had our art directors present tonight very diverse choices to sort of hone in on what he was thinking it should look like, how human should it be. And the script gave us some indications, but when Knight started to see a look that he preferred, he would steer us in that direction, and then we would continue to refine that look. although I have to say it was up through the entire production and into post-production, we were constantly fine-tuning the look of the creature. I think as the scenes were evolving editorially, Knight was getting a clearer view of what he wanted from the alien. Knight's original vision of the creature was slightly more feminine and more graceful. And originally, a woman was brought in and various video and other measurements were taken of her performance to try and create the foundation for how our creature was going to behave. When the creature performed the exact same motions and was superimposed into the scene, I think that everyone felt that the sense of threat was somehow diminished. And so the second phase of the evolution of that creature was for us to, without changing the basic idea, make it feel like it was more of a threatening presence. Initially, the concept of the creature's camouflaging ability was very similar to that we've seen perhaps in other movies where the entire creature could render itself invisible. When we created that look on film as sort of a preview image, I think that Knight felt it was too science fiction-y, too movie magic trick photography. And the movie is very much about the emotions and the reality of this family, and to put in something that would take the audience out of that sequence by making them notice the fancy visual effects was a mistake. So after a lot of trial and error, we came up with basically a slight revision to the character, which was that it did have this camouflaging ability, but only in that the pattern or the texture of its skin would change color. It doesn't disappear, but it's just harder to see.
Scream! Cut. Really great.
The scene in which the creature turns and we see the image of the girl's face on its back is the original photography from the set, and Rory's being suspended on wires on the set. The creature shop here at ILM created an animatronic hand. This was used in two sequences that also involve visual effects. One was in the pantry sequence, when Mel is looking under the door of the pantry and this hand sort of rushes out.
Action.
Because it was an animatronic hand, we filmed it rushing out from under the door on the set. But then we wanted to actually show that its fingers were being cut off. So halfway through the scene, we transitioned to our computer-generated hand. It looks exactly the same. The audience can't tell the difference. But now a computer-generated knife can come in and cut off the fingers. In the end sequence, when we actually see that the alien is holding Rory Culkin, it felt more realistic to use the hand, and since that was working, why should we change it? So what we did is we put in the rest of the creature from the elbow on back is all computer generated. That was filmed here at ILM on a blue screen stage, and the reason for that was by this point in the evolution of the scene, we knew that we wanted the creature to be a little bit more frightening, a little bit more kind of wild, almost like a crazed drug addict has come into your house. And so we dressed up a very big, very strong actor in a blue outfit and had him do the performance that Knight was looking for. And then the boy was put into the background scene already filmed, and instead of our big blue actor, we put in our creature. The creature in the movie is only seen briefly, but has to be completely identifiable to the audience exactly what its intentions are by its behavior. If you look at all the other performances in the scene from the human actors, they've all got a specific style to what they're doing. And I think the challenge in this film was for us to make our synthetic character follow that same type of performance. One of the most difficult points to get across in a very quick amount of time was the fact that the one weakness, the Achilles heel to this alien, was that it could not stand water on it. And so we looked at a lot of various chemicals, acids, what peroxide does, and we found that there was a foaming quality to the acids as they ate into the materials, and that this would be a great visual cue for us to incorporate in the event so that the audience would understand that it's not just that it doesn't like water, it doesn't like getting wet. This is actually damaging the creature. And then, of course, revealing what we call the meat-looking part of the creature, the muscles underneath the skin, it was very clear that this was very damaging to the creature. The creature is memorable in this film because it's so well dramatically supported. I think that's the difference. You can have the best looking, the best designed creature in a movie. If it's not supported by the story, if it's not important to the movie, it's very forgettable. In this film, the entire tapestry of the story is woven around these culminating events, and I think that the juxtaposition of this fantastic creature creature in the family house threatening the child is a very memorable sequence.
Okay, now turn him again. Ready?
It was a very emotional process, but we got to that level, and the level was, you're not supposed to think about it. It's supposed to be real, and it's supposed to be in the movie.
Swing away, Meryl.
It's not supposed to suddenly turn into a sci-fi movie. It's always been this kind of hybrid movie between a drama and sci-fi, and should stay that way. It's been super rewarding. I would do it again, and I feel like I have so much more knowledge about the process that I can do it again a little better.
Cut. Very nice.
All right.
Very nice, Roy.
And we cut. Right.
The last 5 weeks of making this movie. I just finished locking the movie just a few days ago, and I flew out here to Los Angeles to do the score here with the full orchestra with James Newton Howard. And it's really a beautiful end to the process of filmmaking, because it's basically 100 people playing the musical emotion that you've decided on, and it's a very powerful thing. This whole process of a year and a half of making it from the time I wrote it, they're finally doing the last voices of it, and it's a big deal to be there at the last moment. First of all, I feel like, music is used way too much in movies as a crutch, as a band-aid, as I believe that editing is used as a band-aid to cover up poor storytelling. So to avoid both those things, I cut as little as possible to hold myself to those kind of things.
I mean, if they could just give that like 5% more emotion, in playing this, it's...
That's right.
I don't know how to get that.
Well, they just... Right. I think if we just do it again, and they'll get it right. It's really one of those things you just get.
Just say 5% more love. Every single movie, the last three movies, there's been a moment where I go, we're not going to score this movie.
Don't score the horror part of this movie at all. And only score the flashback out to the Meryl epiphany, all the epiphany stuff,
But my process always starts that way. We're not going to have any music in this movie, all right, James? Just don't worry about it. And then James understands the story so well, the story that we're telling. I come in and I say, well, what would you do here?
There's always an enormous advantage to working with somebody more than once, provided it's a good relationship to start with. And when Knight and I first met on The Sixth Sense, he felt that the music really didn't have a singular life of its own beyond the movie. But by the time we got into Unbreakable, we had become friends to an extent, so the rapport was more complete, it was easier. And we started an idea, which we followed through with Signs, where having storyboarded the movie for me, I then returned to Los Angeles and wrote music before he started shooting the movie.
I gave him the screenplay, and I brought him down to Philadelphia, and I brought the music editor down, and I walked them through the movie. I literally talked them through the movie. I said, okay, the movie opens like this, and I showed them the drawings, all the storyboards, and I literally performed the movie for however it took me, like an hour and a half.
The main title that you see over the opening of the movie was written before the movie was ever shot, and it's based on a three-note motif. And that motif is reprised throughout the movie in all kinds of benevolent, hostile, threatening, mysterious kinds of ways. It was not specifically written to be the main title. In fact, when we first listened to it and evaluated it, we wondered if, in fact, there was anywhere in the movie for this music to exist, although we both thought it was somehow related. And I think it was kind of a stroke of genius, because it starts the movie off in such a mind-blowing way, and just the level of intensity, it's very unexpected. What it does is it sets up a context of expectations. So you know that what you're listening to in the main title is going to happen sometime in the movie. You just don't know where, and you don't know quite how. It informs people about what they're about to see.
I said, James, everything's gonna come from that. And he didn't write anything for a long time. He went away and he actually did another movie. And then I went and shot the movie and edited the movie. And then once I gave up that thing of, there's gonna be no music, I came to James and I said, all right, What would you do? So then he started pulling things from that 2.5 minutes and elaborating on it.
I don't want the force issue. It's just me. I just need a little bit more. We're talking about a little bit more at 65.
The last sequence was, without question, the most difficult film music I've ever written, the biggest challenge. It starts off as a moment of utter disbelief and shock and horror. Goes through moments of recognition.
Hi, sweetie.
Hi, baby.
The building part after the flashback when he sees the bat on the wall, that's three-note motif. And very quickly does an about face and ends up in a very tender moment. The whole thing was about structure, which is really the secret to any writing, whether it's music or words. I was trying to go back to my three-note motif as much as possible. That's when the music is really sort of flexing its muscle, and these three notes have really sort of unified to be a force. It was just the most difficult getting it right kind of process that I've ever been through.
For me so far, Tom, I would go first half, this one.
Yeah.
Half meaning up to the, yeah. Up to the couch.
Okay.
And then couch on.
Let's do one more line.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay, great.
And I just want a couple adjustments.
Let's do it. Great.
Knight and I will oftentimes have two points of view. His point of view will be performance-oriented, which is an incredibly valid point of view, that one felt right. It may be loose, the violins may have not been very together, and we had problems with the percussion, but it had an energy and a rawness that really appeals to me. And then I'm sitting there as the professional musician, saying, well, it's really hard for me to get over all the flaws of that performance, and I really need an opportunity to work that stuff out, and it's a bargaining thing. So I think we go after it until we both feel confident that that was the one, and that's what happened in the end.
The final step is I go to New York and I do the final mix of the movie, and all I'd be thinking about is the balance of dialogue, sound effects, music. So all those decisions go on for the last month. And they can only go on when I don't have to worry about CGI, when I don't have to worry about the music, when I have to worry about editing, when I don't have to worry about looping a dialogue. All that's done, and I have all the elements, and now I can go, how do I want them to be heard?
I think my music sounds better with effects, with sound effects, with some crashes, with the monster screaming. That was how it was designed. If I was going to write for absolute silence, I would have written different music. So I'm very comfortable with the collaborative aspect. I will defend my music as sort of comfortably and as strongly as is appropriate, but at a certain point, I relinquish control of it and understand the fact that, you know, this is somebody else's movie they made, and I am there to enhance and realize some vision with this idea. So we always get there.
With Sixth Sense, we had a cut with no music, and Unbreakable with no music, and Signs, especially Signs with no music. They all have this poetry to them where you can hear the subtle voices of the writing and the acting. And then ultimately, when you believe this movie can play with no music, not a drop of music from beginning to end, then you trust that James Newton Howard, your partner, can come in and improve the movie. Mm-hmm. 5% more love would cover all of this.
5% more love is the direction.
5% more love is the direction. You have this drive of, I gotta get this story out, and it's really important to me to get this story out emotionally. And then the filmmaker, businessman comes in and says, you know, to my head and says, you know, it's gotta be a success, gotta do this, you know? We have to orient it here, we gotta promote it like this, we gotta put it out here. You know, and you start thinking about all these things, and there's a big side of me that's hardcore businessman, because I choose to make a career based on my emotions. So I'm not gonna lay myself out there and then just get, you know, executed. And so we started really early on talking about the trailer and what we wanted to achieve. We came up with this beautiful idea of doing many trailers, starting with a teaser, then doing the full-out trailer.
Don't be afraid.
I wouldn't let them use the words The Sixth Sense. They did it on the very first teaser, and I said, don't do it anymore. Because it, for me, says, doesn't trust what's coming next. It doesn't let it have its own life. It says, you're gonna get something that's exactly like Sixth Sense, which is all wrong. Don't put Mel Gibson's face on the poster because it's not just a Mel Gibson movie. He's a character in this movie. So that's how we went about the marketing campaign. You know, basically going, we're gonna show you one of the best movies you've ever seen.
M. Night Shyamalan's Signs, rated PG-13, starts August 2nd.
Premiere was an amazing experience. I chose Lincoln Center to have the premiere because I wanted it to be kind of like a classic setting to introduce the movie to the public. And we got this 1,000-seat theater where usually it's beautiful musicians playing, you know, and we prepped it for the movie, and it was an amazing experience. If I could have bottled that reaction there and sold it, it would have been amazing. It was just like people just screaming and laughing and crying and the applause. It was such a wonderful ride that all 1,000 people just moving as one.
It is the 18th reported crop sign in the last 2 hours.
Critics are calling Signs thrilling. Two thumbs up. The most fun you'll have being scared this summer.
Well, the movie opened 5 days ago and has broken a bunch of records. Biggest movie in Touchstone's history, the opening and all. It's been an amazing 5 days. I'm not quite sure what my emotion is here at this point. I feel wonderful in that we marketed the movie in a challenging way. I didn't want to take away from the movie-going experience just to sell it. And so I put this burden on Disney to kind of sell it by insinuation that we have the goods and come and see this experience. So we could have opened and done poorly because I tied so many hands, you know, and so many things behind, but I'm so proud of the audience for turning out in the numbers they did because it says, look, you treat them with intelligence, you don't pander, and they show up. They show up like they show up to a giant movie.
Signs is the number one movie in America and the film that's being hailed by critics everywhere.
It's happening.
It's one of the year's best films, Mel Gibson. Signs, rated PG-13, now playing.
When I'm editing a movie is usually when I go, ah, that's the idea. You know, as Sixth Sense came out, I was writing Unbreakable on the computer. And Unbreakable, I was deep in thinking about Signs. This is unusual. I don't know what I'm gonna do next. I'm waiting for something. I don't know what it is. I'm waiting for something, maybe to see how this all turns out. Signs was the end of these three movies for me in a way, and I wanna become something else. And I have a few good ideas and I'm just not physically writing them right now. I don't know why. But this is the first time that's ever happened. We'll see what that means in the whole picture of things.